Hello everyone, welcome back to Hate Plus, and I'm so freaking excited to see the new costume that she's designed. Alright, let's go. Here we go, ready to play, yep. Oh, I am ready. Good morning. Good morning to you too, Hyun-ae. I'm really excited. Today is the first day of the Lunar New Year. I know, I am too. Okay, Hyun-ae, this is gonna be so awkward. Hyun-ae, I'm not very good at expressing my feelings with words, okay? But when I was waiting for the ship to recharge, I just couldn't stop thinking about you. God, oh, this is so awkward. Okay, Hyun-ae, I'm not good with words, so I wrote a little song. Don't laugh, please don't laugh. Just listen, okay? I kept trying to sleep, but I couldn't because I kept thinking of you. You're an artificial intelligence, but there's nothing artificial about our love. So let's investigate the past together, and we'll be the best investigators ever. You are amazing, and I wanna be with you forever, forever. Okay, I'm like totally embarrassed. What did you think of it? And never mind. Okay, you don't have to say anything. Let's just move on. I just wanted you to know how I feel. What were you gonna say? I finished making that new Hanbok. I'm really proud of it. I can't wait to see it. Show it to me. Show it to me. Show it to me. I want to see it. The cosplay interface is a little different now, but I think it should be easy to figure out. I'll let you change me into my new Hanbok. Then we can proceed. Okay, let's take a look at it. I can't wait to see it. Okay, let's take a look. Oh my god, it's beautiful! Look at that, it's got butterflies all over it! Wow. Ah, you did it. How much do you know about Korean Lunar New Year traditions? Actually, absolutely nothing. Oh, well, then I guess I'll just have to explain as we go along. Yes, please. Do explain. I'm curious. God, it's so beautiful. Like, seriously, that... That is one of the most beautiful dresses, or I don't even know if you call it dress, beautiful clothes I've ever seen. Ah. So, tell me. What do you think of my new outfit? I think it's pretty. That's an understatement, but yes, I think it's freaking gorgeous. Ah, thank you. That's very nice of you to say. I'm glad you like it. I worked hard on it last night. Anyway, let's start. Normally, you're supposed to start off with putting out a bunch of ritual foods for your ancestors and do some bows. That sounds freaking boring. But okay, maybe it gets more exciting. But I don't really remember what they are. My family would handle that part. Mostly though, it's just... And maybe this is an awful thing to say, but... And I know it's something that my adoptive family believed in strongly, but... It's completely beyond belief for me that my ancestors have been looking over me. If they were, would they have really have let all those things happen? Yeah, I don't think so. No. Hell no. I don't believe it. Neither do I. So, you don't think it'd be wrong to skip that ritual, would you? I don't know. Nope, not after all that. Thanks for understanding. Now, let's move on. The other really important thing I remember about the New Year is that you're supposed to eat... I have no idea how to pronounce that. Tiaguk? Tiaguk? Why does it have two T's? What is that? It's kind of soup. When you have it on New Year's Day, it symbolizes growing a year older. It tastes like, well, sort of, oh. I guess after 622 years, I don't really remember what any food tastes like. That's fair enough. I don't remember what I had yesterday morning. So I wouldn't expect you to know what food tastes like after 622 years. Anyway, though, that's not what's important. What's important is that's how you count how old you are. I remember what it looks like, at least. Ah. Like this. Nice, she made me a picture. What? What are those white things? Water, maybe they're water chestnuts? Or dumplings? Or maybe they're... cocoons? No, probably not. Well, here goes.
What? What? What was that? That was adorable.
Did you just change your avatar then? Sorry, it's the first time I've done this in centuries. I'm sure I got something wrong. But the important thing about rituals is just who you do them with, right? That's what I believe. I agree. I totally agree. Rituals are basically just an excuse to... This is me talking. Rituals are basically just an excuse to get together with people. I really don't care about rituals, just for the sake of rituals. So, since this is the first time I've done this since I was alive, well, if this is my 17th time having it... By that measure, that must mean I'm only really 17 years old. Oh yeah, you did die when you were 16, right? Yeah. That's definitely how it works. That's also what I believe. Well, maybe that's not a good thing to say if we're going to have a relationship together, after all. I'm just being silly, honestly. Well, anyway, I suppose we've wasted enough time with this, haven't we? And I really want to keep reading what we started last night anyway. Especially since there were some pretty dramatic looking things in that list, weren't there? Yep. Well, lead on, Mr. Investigator. What better way to celebrate the new year than by spending it working together with you? Oh, that's so sweet. I honestly, Hyun-ae, I can't think of a better way to spend it either. Hyun-ae, I love you. Ah, damn it, that's right, she can't understand my speech. I only have the dialogue wheel to interact with her. It's okay. She knows. Alright, 42% power. Welp, let's unfortunately have to disable her. Let's disable her and go into the messages. Sorry, Hyun-ae, I'll be back soon. Or rather, you'll be back soon. Because I guess you're the one that's been turned off. Literally. Okay. What should I go with? What's the last thing I read? Well, one of the last thing I read was the development between Mimi and... What was his name? What was his name? Hyo Seong-bok. Yeah. Have I completed M2? You know what? Let's just look for Hyo Seong-bok. I really want to know where that goes. Let me just look for him. Bok, 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 bok. There's gotta be more, right? You know, this is interesting. I wonder when I'm going to get... I wonder when I'm going to get to look at these, the bitmap data. Like this, personal photos. And then look down here, updated wrinkled face textures? What? Are these just jokes or do I actually get to look at them at some point? Because at the moment I can't select them. Anyway. Still looking for him. I don't see him. I don't see him in any of the other ones. Is there anything even from Mimi? I don't think so. Anyway, let's go with M2, and if not that, then M3. Nope, there's M2. M2, M2, M2. Whoa, a lot of M2. Any more? M2, M2, okay, I can't even finish M2. Okay. So can I not do anything with these pictures? Like, bitmap data, Xiao Young's smile. No, I click it, nothing happens. Oh well. Wait, crap, which one did I just deselect? M2, M2, M2. M2, there we go. Must have been that, or actually, wait, no. Must have been that one. I think. I don't know. What? That's good. That's fine. Don't pick the flowers. Rendezvous in the dark. Ooh, sounds nice. I hate the mornings after. I hate the mornings after, too. Hmm. How? I make everything worse. Hmm. Well, this batch sounds filled with tragedy. Okay. God, I can't get over how beautiful that is. Look at that. It's so pretty. Ah. Okay. Oh, Mei Chen Ah. Wait, was that the flower girl or was that the actor? I can't remember which one. I think that was the flower girl. Anyway, let's go by year. 42, 42, 41. Alright, Don't Pick the Flowers review. Muri Monthly. Oh, is that a review of the play? I think it is. Hmm. Attention getting headline. The Silver Eternities production of Don't Pick the Flowers is the current pinnacle of modern theater, with Hyun-ae Chung. Yep, that's her. Was a really glamorous and pretty actress. Yes, she was. And Lee Tae Mi, giving their finest performance to date. Who's that? Have I seen? No. An actor. He was kind of dreamy. Was he? Well, there's no photo, so I couldn't say. Okay. The ever-lovely A. Chong has always been one of our favorite stars ever since this publication started. But for the past half year, it's been obvious, even to the casual theater-goer, that her career has been in somewhat of a slump. In one of her recent performances, she was so visibly spaced out she completely missed cues, and delivered many of the show's important monologues with the stiffness of a stale noodle. I can only speculate as to why, but it's been troubling to watch. Stiffness of a stale noodle. That is not a way you want to have your work described. Lately, however, we've seen a real return to her previous form. A. Chong is as enchanting as a dream. And her onstage chemistry with her co-star Tae Mi produces unbelievably convincing tension. For 3 hours, she becomes the perfect embodiment of love and scorn, taking you through the play's myriad complex turns and betrayals. And make no mistake, this is a difficult play. Don't Pick the Flowers presents the story of the charismatic veteran Earth politician Anna Harper, whose charm blazes a vicious revenge plot against the seductive serial killer Ansa, in yet another cross-dressing role. He was in a cross-dressing role? I'd like to see that. That sounds really interesting, actually. A playboy who uses his status to escape the law. It's a chilling story of manipulation, and the entire play is a duel of wit and charm between the two. A complicated dance where one is never sure who is ahead until the end. In the hands of a less skilled cast or any other director, it could be a mess. But A. Chong and Tae Mi are entrancing, and when done right, the confusion only helps to sell their roles even more. I don't really get why this was included, though. It's kind of boring. If you only see one play this year, it absolutely must be this. I don't know what's happened to A. Chong to bring her back to grace, but we're all the better for it. 5 stars. Don't Pick the Flowers is currently being performed at the Silver Eternity Theater. Okay, she's been in a... According to this review, she's been in a slump, A. Chong, and she's returned to form. I'm thinking she probably returned to form because being with... what was her name? Being with Mei Chen-ah, I think that's brought her back, but let me check the dates. Okay, May 10th, 4041. How do I look at the... May 10th, 4041, how do I go back to check the other ones? I guess it'd be one. Let's Look for it, look for it, look for it. I don't see it. Nope. Let's look at 2, M2. Okay. Yeah, it was after. I'm thinking you brought her back to life. Or you know, back to form. Revitalized her. But anyway, I guess we're about to find out, because there are some more messages from... I keep forgetting her name. Wait a minute, how do I go back to the previous screen? I guess I have to do it through here now. Anyway, they're all on M2. Actually, wait, you can do all on red, right? Show unread, yeah. Here we go. Okay, yeah, I hate the mornings after. That must be it. Alright, so let's go for that. I hate the mornings after. 1, by Mei Chin-a. Who is freaking adorable. Aw, cute. I don't think anything Mei Chin-a can do can be uncute. I mean, look. Mei Chin-a was a cute girl who sold flowers for a living. I mean, just look at her and how she writes, and she even sells flowers. How could she be more adorable? Dear Diary, oh, I am so in love. I just got home, and after I finish eating, I need to get to work. But right now, I gotta write this all down because, girl feelings! Yesterday, on our date together... Yep, that's her. How do you pronounce that? A? I don't know. Actually held my hand, in public. I thought she was worried about being seen with me like that before, but I guess she changed her mind. And that was even before dinner. I mean, afterwards, I wouldn't have been surprised, because she insisted on us going through a lot of wine together, and she gets really possessive of me when she does that. Please, my dear, I insist, she told me as she ordered the second bottle. Money might be tight these days, but it's worth it to see you get all giggly and affectionate. What? I don't even know what you're talking about, I said, but then I couldn't help but giggle. Oh, fine. Is that what wine makes you do? I've never had any. I mean it truly, especially with how little I seem to see you lately, she said sadly. Well, we'll be able to spend more nights together once we're able to get a place of our own, right? I asked. I really can't wait until we can. If I could take her back to my home, it would be fine. But haha, oh, no way am I sleeping with her with my parents on the other side of the screen. Getting a place of our own on the same deck is still the only option. I can't wait. Yeah, that would be super awkward. Yeah. Other side of the screen. Why wouldn't she? Is A-Chong a noisy sleeper? Oh, Hyun-ae. You know what she means. Right, she said, and then took another drink. Afterwards, we went back to her cozy apartment behind the theater, and we drank some more. It pretty quickly got to the point in the evening where she could just not keep her hands off me, which, oh my gosh, I still cannot deal with it at all. At all. You know, I stammered, if you keep being like that with me in public, all those fangirls who call you Big Sister are going to get jealous. My, are they now? She said in that super husky voice of hers that just totally makes me melt. Then she started to stroke my hair. I wish... Sadly, there's not many of them anymore. Single girls just don't go to the theater these days, it seems. Good, I said. I want you all to myself. I do miss all the love letters, though. My, they would say the most flattering things, she teased me. Then she walked over to the futon and slipped out of her dress like it was the most natural thing ever, and oh my gosh, just every time I see her naked, I'm just so blown away. This is really... Ooh, is this gonna get dirty? Okay, let's get into this, okay? I hope this gets crazy like the Mimi and I keep forgetting his name, but you know, the one with Mimi and the other guy. Yes, let's go. Just every time I see her naked, I am just so blown away. That gorgeous black hair resting on her soft, totally smooth, perfect curves, and those long legs and long fingers and perfect, just Jeez, I have to stop. I can't do her justice at all with my babbling, but she could do anything to me after seeing that, and she knows it. Well, I could call you that too, and I know way more about what makes you beautiful than all those girls did anyway. Do you? She said, staring at me, and giving me that look. Good thing I was way drunk past the point of anything but blushing all the time. Because that really would have done it otherwise, and then she just teased me for that too. Come here, she told me, gesturing. I had no choice but to do what she said. Keep going. She undressed me quickly. It's her way of showing that she's in control. And I still get pretty nervous. I mean, really, I'm just terrified. What if she realizes just how much out of my depth I am compared to her? It's not as bad as it used to be. Especially that first time she saw my boobs. But oh my gosh, I just feel so aware of how gross and sweaty my body is. And how it's got little hairs where she's perfectly smooth. And how my boobs are tiny compared to hers. And just, I don't know what she sees in me. I love her, and I know she loves me back, but I just don't get it sometimes. Is that normal for a girl's body? What do you mean? Having hairs? Well, yeah, humans tend to have hairs in many places. Anyway, all the talk about hairs has cooled this down. Hold on, we need to heat it up again. Keep going. Oh, here we go. But then she pulled me onto her lap and we kissed, and then we both giggled at how we tasted like the peach drinks we'd just finished off. Every time we do this, I just suddenly really, really want to play with her boobs, because oh my gosh, they're the softest. Then she gives me a look, and I stop. But, well, after a while this time, I just couldn't get over how perfect her body is. This isn't just love-struck rambling. It really, really is perfect. Ah, oh geez, oh geez, oh geez. I ended up kissing her neck, and even that was just so soft. I don't really know what came over me, but I kinda really felt like biting her. I don't know, I feel bad now, but I just felt like I really wanted to leave a blemish on that super perfect body of hers. And I guess, to show that she was taken. I don't know, it's stupid and it sounds awful when I say it now, but I started out gentle and she let me, so I kept going. And didn't even stop when she cried out. I didn't even think to stop. All I could think of when I heard that moan of hers was that gosh, I wanted to hear more. When I pulled my head back to look at her, it was just, oh gosh, it really did stick out so much. Her complexion perfect and skin totally smooth in every other way, except for that big red blemish. And knowing that it was mine, I felt like I really wanted to do it again. But then she grabbed me strongly and kept kissing me. Then she pinned me down and went at it more. I wanted to apologize, but she wouldn't even let me say anything. But I'm pretty bad at using words around her. I'm really glad we have a relationship like this. Because if I couldn't kiss her, I don't know if I could... If I could... I think that's misspelled. I don't know if I could ever really tell her how I felt. That sounds like I... Hyun-ae is so adorable when she's getting all blushy and embarrassed. Then she went down on me, and I just completely, totally melted under her. I really wish I'd done the same for her, even though she's pretty much a natural at making me cry out, and I never know what I'm doing. But we pretty much both passed out right there before I could. When we woke up, we were both all just tangled up together naked, on top of her sheets, and she'd slept with her head on my waist. I really didn't want to leave. I hate the mornings after. Why do our amazing evenings have to end? Gosh, I'm just so in love with her. I wish it was possible to just spend an entire day with her and not worry about having to work and scramble home in the mornings and why don't we already live together? It's not fair. That was awesome. I love the writing in this game so much. It's such a great mixture of sad and adorable and erotic and cute. And by the way, every time something gets really hot, I'm gonna get nice and close to the microphone. Yes. Gotta make it pop, you know? That sounded sexual. I mean, you gotta make the story pop. Not, you know what I mean. Yeah. So hey, how's everyone doing out there? Let's return to menu. It felt so good to press that button. Yeah. Okay. Ooh, I hit the mornings after from her perspective. Hyun-ae. I can't pronounce anyone's names. I know I'm getting them all wrong. I don't know. Unfortunately, the pronunciation guide that existed in the last game is totally gone here. Which is very unfortunate. But anyway, yeah, so this is from her perspective. Maybe it'll get hot again. Oh, that's bad. Uh-oh, that doesn't sound good. In fact, it doesn't sound good, it actually sounds bad. Which is... that was a stupid thing to say. Totally superfluous. Anyway. With every passing day comes increasing worries about what the next will bring. My only reprise from my fears comes during my rare dates with my cute flower, Hyun-ae, or Hyun-ae. But more and more, I truly hate these mornings after, for she has to return to the world of commoners and family. And I will return to mine to discover that attendance at the Silver Eternity has dropped again. And such patron has threatened to rescind their donation. Beside me, I watch the naked form of my love selfishly sleeping as I write. And I have both overwhelming desire to join her and trepidation towards the inevitable awakening the next morning. I long for nothing more than to be able to rest my head on her forever and never have to leave. God, that's so sweet. What does she mean by that? I don't know. I guess I'm about to find out. Yet I cannot, and I know that things are troubled. Before she arrived at the theater to pick me up, I was in conversation with a patron who offered, as many others have, to alleviate all my financial worries, at the price of offering him something of mine that my beloved wants all to herself. Oh. Well, I think it's pretty clear what she means by that, Hyun-ae. Is that... With a patron who offered as many others have, to alleviate all of my financial worries at the price of offering him something of mine that my beloved wants all to herself. Many patrons. So many people have done that. What I'm wondering is this a common, like, is that an accepted thing in society at this point? At this point in the story? Or is that like a back alley kind of dark thing that you don't talk about? Or is it open? I don't know. Anyway, I let him show the typical amount of inappropriate affection, his hand on my cheek as he made his extraordinary demand, and when I declined, it was not out of a sense of dignity, but out of love for Hyun-ae. Still, she walked in that sight, and while she said nothing, I'm certain that it worried her. Uh-oh. Just explain it to her, she'll get it. I tried to make it up to her with displays of over-affection, as I cannot bear the thought of worrying her cute little head. I held her hand as we walked to the restaurant, and even let her order a second bottle of wine. Wait a minute. I'll get back to that in a minute. That's interesting. Every time I am with her, my mind enters an endless spiral of worries that the moment is wrong, or that I am not delivering enough. I don't know if that will ever go away. Perhaps that's simply how love is. Despite my age and my pretenses, I have little genuine experience in such matters. Wow, she's so worried about letting her down. But Hyun-ae was just as worried about letting her down. They're both worried about the same thing for no good reason. When we returned to my dingy room behind the theater, we ended up drinking more still, and it's in that state I find myself to be so emotionally vulnerable. These days, there seems to be no single girls in attendance at the theater. Only families and grandmothers and old men, I lamented. Gone are the days of rich girls lining up to deliver love letters to me. Do I miss them so? You'll have to settle for me, she said, with her usual indifferent enthusiasm. I don't know how she keeps it up. I envy it. It's what gives me the energy to keep going, remembering that innocent smile of hers. I wanted her so much. I wanted to embrace her and to be overwhelmed with immediate passion for her. Such that I could forget my lamentations and melancholy and simply live in the moment where I am naked before her excited smile. I know more about what makes you beautiful than all those girls did anyway, she told me, appraisingly, as I undressed and waited for her in bed. Ooh, this might get hot again. Do you? I wondered wistfully. She did, of course. She knew my vulnerability. She knew my weakness. With all those girls, even when I took them off to my bed, it was always so easy to me. I always knew that I was prettier and more desirable and more confident, and that not even for a second would I ever lose control of the situation. I would make them squirm and gasp and shudder for my amusement at my will, never fearing that I was ever giving any less than exactly what they wanted from me. With her, though, it's special. I feel as though I have to try so hard to please her, as though she is the one who is perfect and in control, and I never have the confidence that I can meet her expectations. But I try so hard. Come here, I begged her, reaching out and longing. For some reason, the thought that she might not come to... That she might not, came to mind and scared me. But she did. Okay, here we go. I undressed her when she let me, letting her show that she was in control. Even in that facet. Oh, okay. I was just misreading that. Sorry, misreading things tends to take away the mood. Let's go for that again. I undressed her when she let me, letting her show that she was in control even in that facet. We kissed, and when she started to giggle, I could scarcely help myself from doing the same. Despite my worries and melancholy? Then, she took my body onto her lap and my chest into her strong, calloused hands, gripping me tightly, only enough for a tease, though, only enough to make me stare at her longingly for the feeling of her rough fingers playing with me. My breasts themselves were only in her grip for seconds, but my heart still now remains ever firmly in her grasp. Then she started to bite my neck, at first gently, to give me a chance to decline, as if I could say no to her, but then stronger, until I couldn't help but moan in pain and delight. When she was done, I touched my neck. It was so sensitive, so tender compared to the skin around it, and I felt so happy that she had found a way to leave me with something. An outward show of her love that wouldn't disappear when she left for work. I had to thank her. I had to kiss her, showing my gratitude in the most eloquent way I know how. As I pinned her down, giving her attention where she most deserved it, I felt like, for that moment, all our barriers to communication had been lifted, that I knew what I was doing was good enough for her, and what she wanted from me, and that I had nothing else in the world more to worry about save for trying to draw more pleased noises out of her. She got louder and louder as I dedicated myself to her, letting out the most perfect wavering murmurs, gripping tightly to the sheets. I wish I could have heard that last ecstatic moan again and again. It was what I was longing for, her most explicit display of love and approval. And then she fell asleep, and I was brought back to the real world, the one where I can only rarely see my love, where the holder of that innocent smile speaks of naive dreams of living together, that with each day we can afford increasingly less. And so I write down my feelings in the hopes that I can hold on to them when she leaves and perhaps find strength and comfort in them. I feel really sad for her though, me too. And now I will go sleep at her side as long as I am able. And naked before her, adorned only by her mark on my neck, I'll declare I love her as much as I hate the mornings after. Once again, incredibly sweet and cute, and also really sad. Christine Love is really good at writing that sort of thing. It's sweet, and it's so nice, but it's also so sad. Okay, now there's something I was going to examine. Hold on, let me think for a second. Okay. There seems to be a big difference in how Hyo-ae Chung and... Oh god, what was her name? It's strangely slow to scroll up. Hyun-ae and Hyo-ae Chung. There seems to be a big difference in how they see each other. Like, they both seem to think that they might disappoint each other and they're trying to impress each other, but there's something else here that was even more interesting than that. Where was it? Hold on. I think it was up. Yeah, it's up, okay. Yeah, look at this. I held her hand as we walked to the restaurant and even let her order a second bottle of wine. She said she let her order a second bottle of wine. Hold on, let's go back. to her perspective. Sorry, I really want to talk to you, though. Give me a second. Just a second, Hyun-ae. I'm following a train of thought, and I don't want to lose it. Yeah, wait, look at this. I mean, afterwards, I wouldn't have been surprised, because she insisted on us going through a lot of wine together. Look, Hyun-ae is saying that she, God, I keep forgetting everyone's name. Hyo-ae Chung was insisting on her getting more wine. Please, my dear, I insist, she told me as she ordered the second bottle. What is going on? That's weird. Hyun-ae is saying, please, my dear, I insist. Hyun-ae is explicitly saying that, Hyo-ae Chung was the one ordering the wine. However, Hyo-ae Chung was saying that she let Hyun-ae order the wine. What? There's a complete difference there. They're like the opposite. Are they just remembering wrong? Is it just because of their feelings are making them like color the past, or is this something deeper? I wonder. It might be nothing, but I suspect it isn't nothing. Why would there be such a difference in perception? Anyway, okay. Sorry, Hyun-ae. What'd you want to say? Sorry, I know this is embarrassing, but it's still weighing really heavily on my mind. Hyun-ae, with everything we've read, I don't think anything could be embarrassing at this point. What is it? All these people, married or not, talking so much about sex, and they talk about expressing their love in so many different ways. As for me, though, well, you already know, but I was only ever with my husband. I know. This is embarrassing to admit, but I remember I actually really enjoyed that at the time. Yeah, I remember. That was one of the... Wasn't that one of the two things that you actually enjoyed about your life? Being with your husband, and what was the other one? There was another one, but I can't remember what it was. But yeah, I remember that. But now, when I think about it, I can't really remember why. Maybe it's something you need to have a body to understand. I just don't remember what it feels like at all. That doesn't surprise me, after 600 plus years. If you don't remember what food tastes like, well, I mean, why would you remember anything else? That requires you to have a body. All those things from having a body that you don't have anymore, they would just fade away. But still, I hope this isn't sudden, but can I ask you something? Sure, you can ask me anything you want, Hyun-ae. What do you think relationships are all about? Carrying on your family? Hell no. Okay. Well, it really depends on the relationship. Some can just be about having fun, some can be about love. It's interesting that you can actually see her expression. Like, I guess you can see how she's going to perceive it. If you just mouse over it, like, carrying on with your family. Carrying on your family, she obviously looks angry at that, as she should. Well, yeah, it depends on the relationship, but For me personally, it would be about love. Ah, that's so romantic of you. I guess I am kind of romantic. I think love is really important too. Reading about all these relationships from the past, somehow I get the feeling that they all believed in love. Oh, definitely, me too. Absolutely. Or maybe at least they were all about being there for each other. And I guess, being together in that way was just a part of that? Definitely, yeah, I mean, it's not everything. It's just a part of it. If I was with someone I loved, I think I'd really like that even more. The idea of it being such a passionate, active thing for both people is so different from what I experienced. Yeah, I mean, what she experienced was just totally passive. It was with someone she didn't like at all. And she was just you know, she was just someone there having it done to her. There was no equality, there was no real passion between them, there's no love at all. So yeah, actually having sex with someone you actually like would be something totally different. Totally different. I wonder, what's that like? Well, Seongbok really makes it sound like a good thing. Reading about all this might be a little embarrassing and so foreign to me, but it makes me feel like I can believe in romance again, that it's not just some childish thing. And it makes me want to experience, well, you know, something that intense. Anyway, I'm sorry, I'm babbling about such an embarrassing thing. No, you're not, it's fine. Let's get back to reading. Not that I mean I just want to read things that are dirty. Oh, you don't? Are you sure? Are you sure, Hyun-ae? I wouldn't mind. Just investigating. I want to get back to reading so we can continue investigating. Sure, sure. Jeez, let's just get back to it. She's so adorable when she's embarrassed. Oh, wait. I just realized I have an unread message. When did that pop up? Has that been there the whole day? Layover on Earth. Tourism Earth. February 10th. A 24-hour layover on Earth can be brutal for most travelers, but it doesn't have to be. With most spaceports linked by orbital rail transit, taking a day trip on the surface has never been easier. Remember, days on Earth are traditionally segmented into 7 days per week. Yes, I remember. With most regions observing one or two of those days off, make sure you're not trying to visit during a weekend day or you might be terribly disappointed. Here's some of our favorite lesser frequented day trips that anyone can experience on Earth. But hopefully I'm pronouncing this right. Pyongyang Gardens. Open to the public all days, but tours unavailable on Monday or Tuesday. Like most major metropolitan areas in a region, Pyongyang is climatized to a year-long comfortable spring. So while the countryside will be buried in snow in February, it's February right now. The city itself is nice and warm, perfect for watching the flowers bloom on its famous rooftop gardens. I just got the most beautiful image of Hyun-ae put into a physical body, and us watching the flowers bloom. God, that sounds amazing, doesn't it? Lake City Ruins, closed to the public on Sundays. Experience a guided tour through the preserved ruins of Lake City to see a glimpse of quaint 23rd century life. Quaint 23rd century life. Tour routes are well marked, well monitored, and completely safe for any visitor. For those not interested in long hikes, a trip on the recently restored electric underground rail system is still a must-see. Atlantis Science Museum, closed on Sunday mornings. All of the Science Museum's exhibits are worth visiting, but the current special holography exhibits on both dinosaurs and other prehistoric animals and the Lunar War are absolutely outstanding and must be seen. Plus, a 3-hour trip counts as your annual education requirement, just going to show that learning can be fun. I wonder if I'm actually going to get to do that in this game. That would be amazing. If we get back to Earth and we actually get to interact a bit. God, that'd be great. Alright, show unread. How many more do I have? I think four? No, three. Yeah. Alright. 43, 43, 42. So this is the... Oh, Rendezvous in the Dark review. It's another review. But I don't know what a Rendezvous in the Dark is. Is that another one with starring... Oh, it is. Tamed. Huh. That isn't really funny. Wait, Tamed. Let's find out what she means. It's not that Rendezvous in the Dark has no redeeming qualities, or that it fails at what it sets out to do. It's about Miss Hong, Hyo-ae Chong, a troublemaking schoolgirl with a heart of ice, and her overwhelmingly generic upperclassman, Kill. Lee Tae Mi. Is that the... Yeah, okay, that's the one she works with all the time. Who, for reasons of plot contrivances, end up chasing around and antagonizing each other for two long acts until the end, where Hong is naturally tamed, and the two marry. Whoa, yeah, wait, what? Tamed? Tamed? What the f- that is a very disturbing way to put it. A tamed schoolgirl. Yeah. And the two marry. As far as this kind of mediocre play goes, it's the best I've seen, but the pinnacle of mediocrity is still mediocrity. The problem is, it doesn't tell a compelling story, or have any cohesive themes. Because it's not supposed to, it's designed to be broken up into short, humorous scenes, each with a punchy conclusion, so that the work out of context when performed in front of a private home audience as a form of disposable entertainment. See our editorial this month for a less cranky take on the changing demographics of the theater. And it is disposable entertainment. This is a... I don't really get it, but it does sound boring. And this is a play that's supposed to be funny even if your mother-in-law is talking through half of it, and to its credit, it succeeds on that merit. But so what? Is that really the highest goal theater has now? Is this truly the best use of the amazingly talented Eternity Troupe's time? I wonder why they were doing that. Were they getting desperate for money? Is that a moneymaker sort of thing? I mean, if it gets some bad reviews, then... isn't that going to hurt their ability to make money? I don't know. Anyone who truly cares about art and theater will continue to be dismayed. With all that said, if there's one woman in the world who can sell the implausibly bitchy jerk turning into a love-struck wife and imbue the role with perfect comic timing, it's A. Chong. And Lee Tae-mi manages to his own his character through sheer force of his own personality. Whenever he's on stage, although unfortunately, lately his roles at the Silver Eternity's actual theater have been performed by understudies. If you like this sort of thing, Rendezvous in the Dark is absolutely worth seeing. If you only go to the theater to leer at beautiful actresses, well, you can't go wrong with the ever-lovely A. Chong. More discerning audiences should stay away from the pale shadow of what the Silver Eternity used to be. 2 stars. Currently be performed in the entirety of the Silver, yep. Selections are part of the troupe's private performance set. Doesn't sound good. It sounds like she was already having trouble with money, and it sounds like they've just had even more trouble. I wonder why she was having trouble with money so much. Xiao A. Chong, I mean. Because she's a noble, isn't she? Isn't she in one of the classier professions? And Chin-A is a commoner. You know, she sells flowers. So she's kind of looked it down on, and obviously she does not make much money. But between them, between a noble and a commoner, shouldn't they... They're still not making enough? To even get their own place? That's sad. Makes me wonder about how the economy was. How are other people doing? Sounds like the economy was kind of depressed. Anyway. Okay, I make everything worse. Xiao A. Chong, and then the next one is from Mei Chin-A. So yeah, we are definitely on a streak going through their relationship, so let's see what is happening. So this is from after the Rendezvous in the Dark review, quite a bit after. She's so poetic about everything. I fear that I may only be causing my cute little flower, Chin-A, to wilt. That is so poetic, to wilt. Does my presence in her life bring her hardship? By being the subject of her impossible dreams, do I only cause her more suffering when the seams of the artifice become exposed? Seams of the artifice? What artifice? I fear that I give her false hope, a false sense of security, and that it will only make things worse when I fail her. Worse, I find myself shielding her from the truth I wanted to tell her about the patronage that I had been reluctantly forced to consider. And that was my intent when I came to see her. I knew something so pivotal to my future, and therefore hers, was something I needed to discuss with her. When I arrived at her family's stand on the plaza, at closing time, a man who I rightfully assumed was her father was engaged in an intense-looking conversation with her. I would have stood nearby and wait for them to finish, but when he saw me, he walked out without another word. Uh-oh. This doesn't sound good. A troubled look was on his face as he passed me by. And he just shook his head at me. In retrospect, I know exactly what that look signified, and I cannot in good faith disagree with the sentiment. For I know it was out of earnest concern for his daughter's, my love's, well-being. But at the time, I knew not what to make of it, and was more concerned with Chin-A herself. Well, fathers don't always know what's right. That is very true. No smile lit her reddened face, only tears.
Oh.
She stared at me, quivering, light glistening off her eyes. Then she rushed towards me, and when I hugged her tightly, she let go of whatever inhibition was holding her back and started to cry with great sadness. I felt a pang in my chest to see her so, and all I could do was stroke her hair and tell her, "There, there," as she cried into my shoulder.
Oh god, where is this going? This doesn't sound good.
Oh no, that's exactly what I was thinking. I wished I could find her a more private place than just letting her cry in public, but her home would be more crowded, and the back room I sleep in was in use during the day. If only I still had the apartment behind the theater. At least, there weren't many people about at this hour. After a while, she calmed down a little bit, or at least ran out of energy to keep up the sobbing, and I sat her down. "Oh, little flower, do you wish me to get you some tea to help calm your nerves? Then we can talk about it," I offered. She nodded. "Thanks," she said, and I was grateful, because I needed it for my own nerves as much as she. I left her alone and hurried to the nearest machine I could find to the plaza. When I returned, she didn't seem to have moved at all. I sat down next to her. Oh wow, I forgot about canned tea. I kinda miss it. "Hey," I said to her, wrapping my arm over her shoulder. "Hot or cold?" She sniffled. "Hot, please," she said. I handed her the can. She opened it, took a very long sip, and sighed. "Tell me about it, dear," I told her, pulling her in close. "Dad wants me to get married," she said in a wavering voice. "My family gets paid so little these days. It's so hard with 5 people in our one-room home, and well, look at how big I am. I practically eat enough for 2, she said, laughing awkwardly. Then she started sniffling again and took another sip from her tea. "No, yeah, I know, I'm thinking the exact same thing. Wants me to get married. God damn it, where have we seen this before?" "I mean, it's always been crowded at home, even before Grandma and Grandpa moved in, and I always wanted to move out anyway. But we can't afford to," I said what we both already knew very well. "Or we'd be drinking wine together in a restaurant instead of vending tea in the back of a stall." God, it looks like the commoners are just getting screwed. 5 people in a one-room home. And they can't even sustain themselves with 5 people in a one-room home. What the hell? Jesus. It really doesn't require any stretch of the imagination to figure out in general what happened leading up to the year zero. Some sort of a political unrest, revolt, revolution, something. I mean, you can't keep that up. You cannot. You cannot keep people like that. It just does not work. For a bit, yeah. For a long time, no. Alright. She started to cry again, and I felt another pang in my heart. My levity had only made things worse. No, don't marry some old man. You have someone who loves you.
I know, but that's what I'm thinking, but it's not.
They don't exactly have a choice in the matter. Yeah, she stammered between sobs. Dad was talking to me all... Please, just hear him out. He's a good man. I mean, the guy himself, I'm sure. He's nice, but I want to be with you. I love you, eh? I want to be with you. I held her tightly as her poor tears gripped my heart, and I wished there was anything I could do. What about the stand? Wouldn't you make more money for the family if you could still work? Even if you didn't keep any wages for your own savings, perhaps it'd be better? I asked, expecting there to be an answer for why that wouldn't help. And there was. Apparently the flower stand barely made any money these days, and what didn't go to rent instead went for plaza bribes to desperate nobles. It sounded like the only reason they had it now still was for her own sake. Jesus. Maybe I'll run away. I could take the savings and just sleep behind the theater at night, and try to find odd work during the day or just something, she cried out, tears falling from her face. Do you know why this man wants to marry some girl he's never met? Do you know why? I asked. He's just as poor as us. Do you know why? Even though I'm ugly and too young, and I'm just some random stranger, and there's no love or anything? Taxes. Because there's some big tax break for new fathers. Taxes. Jesus. They're both poor. And they just marry for taxes? Fuck. I hate that this is even possible. That this sort of a situation would even arise. That's horrible. Fucking taxes and money coming in the way of love. I had, in fact, known. It was a recent big political issue, but I said nothing and let her have her moment. She took another sip from her can, then suddenly crushed it in her fist. I don't want to have a kid. She stared at me with a look of absolute horror, starting to wail. I don't want to have a kid. I don't care how nice he is. I don't want to move in with some strange man and have sex with him and get knocked up and then have to raise some stupid kid and then never see you. I don't want to. I don't want to. I don't want to. This really hurts to read. Just... I know, this... This mirrors what Hyun-ae went through in many ways. Just, wow. She started to hyperventilate, and all I could do was hold her, hush her, and tell her to breathe, until she calmed down a little. Maybe I'll run away, she said again, wiping her face with her sleeve. Do you think you could? If your parents were going to force you to do such a thing. Would you be able to go against them? I asked her, knowing entirely that she never would. She said nothing, but grabbed me tightly and I stared at her poor, swollen face, her tear-filled eyes looking so, so hurt. And then I thought of my own situation. How not only could I not comfort this poor, hurt girl that I had allowed to depend on me for comfort? How not only had I let her down, but how also my future was just as doomed as she was, having so much trouble admitting hers was. Her only hope lied in a loveless, sham marriage, mine in the graces of a private patron. Either way, our love would inevitably be torn asunder. At least it would offer stability, somehow escaped my lips. I hadn't meant to think aloud like that. She had no words. She only grabbed me tighter and started to wail loudly again. She cried a river of tears against my breast, sobbing uncontrollably, and I found myself overwhelmed by pity. I started to cry a little too, and forced myself to remain silent, lest I somehow find a way to worsen the scenario even more. If that's what love's like, maybe it's better that I never knew it. God, this is horrible. Jesus. Oh, fuck. Yep, I knew the game would turn from extremely cute and would go darker and darker, and it is. Damn it, 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 damn it. Okay, one more. Mei Chena. This is about 2 or 3 weeks after the last one. Okay, please, I'm crossing my fingers. Please have good news. Please. Something good. Please. Oh no, but they were so good together. No, don't say that, Hyun-ae. Fuck. Dear Diary, I can't believe she'd do that to me. I hate her. She's the worst. I hope she gets what she deserves from the man who's decided... She deserves from the man she's decided to leave me for. How could she do that to me? Hate, 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 hate. Ah, fuck. This is just like, what was his name? Something Bok, or Byok, or something like that. And Mimi. This is just like that. Mimi was going to marry someone, just for money. And that was ruining the relationship. And once again, they're, well, not marrying. Well, I mean, she's not marrying, but she's getting a patron just for money. But again, it's ruining their relationship. God damn it. It all comes down to freaking money. Ruining these relationships. Just money. How sick is that? I was at the theater to tell her my decision about... Oh no no, oh geez, I just realized how badly I screwed that up for me. All because I was stupid enough to be lovestruck by that stupid, selfish woman. Oh no. Oh no, what am I going to do now? I was at the theater to tell her my decision about that man my parents wanted me to marry. He was so icky, I told her. He was like a dozen years older than me, and had this beard that was just... yuck. Well, I'm sure you could convince him to shave it, she said distantly. I was surprised. Oh, I think I know how this ends. Me too. I think I know too, and I don't want it to be true. Don't defend him. I could never live with someone like that. Besides, I'd have to be away from you, and I could never... I trailed off. Anyway, I told him no, I was totally uninterested, and that he should go find some girl his age instead, and maybe ask her directly instead of being around, instead of going around to her parents. My father was upset, but I had to. So that's the end of that. We have to break up, she said suddenly. Nothing else, nothing leading into it, just that.
God damn it.
Damn it. I don't really remember what I said. I don't think I believed her. I know I stammered a lot, probably, what? There's a patron who'd like to buy me out and take me into his house. It's something I've considered for a long time now, and I'm afraid it's come to the point where it's the only recourse I can take, she said. He's made a very generous offer, and I fear it would be unwise of me to decline it.
Damn it.
Buy you out? What does that even mean? I asked. Are you going to move in with this man? It means I will receive a regular stipend for performing for him and his guests exclusively, and that, yes, I will live in his house and receive 3 cooked meals a day and an actual bed to sleep in. She said, I have to. We get smaller and smaller audiences every week. This just isn't tenable. I just couldn't believe it. My mind raced. I just turned down an offer like that for her sake, and she did this to me?
That's right, she did. She just... Oh, fuck.
She turned away her offer. But... A Chong didn't.
Oh, that's gotta... hurt so much.
Is it that man I saw you with before? The one you've been doing all those private shows for? The one who's all in your face and touching you and like... Oh, my precious Ai Chong, I could be honored to slobber all over you like some gross man. Please come into my home now, I demanded. That guy from the Ryu house you said you didn't want to have anything to do with? I think she's being a little harsh, though.
She is
being a bit harsh. I mean, it's not like Ai Chong hates her. Obviously not. She feels like she's let her down. Like, Hyun-ae has depended on her, but she can't actually provide for her in any way. She can't be what she wants. So she's trying to sever it, and I'm sure for Ai Chong, it has to hurt so much. That isn't fair. Yes, it is him, but... She trailed off. Yeah, I bet he'll give you a bed to sleep in, I shouted. Don't say that, Hyun-ae. It's not like that, she lied. Besides, even were it like that, I no longer have the luxury of being picky. If I said no, what would I do when the theater closed down? At least you can live with your parents still. I have no such option. The man has made a kind and generous offer, and I must accept it. I can't believe it, I said, crying. I thought you loved me. I thought you cared for me. But you're better off without me, anyway, she said. Then she told me, I can't really remember her exact words now, but she told me that she didn't feel so strongly about me as I did for her. And that she regretted being a crutch for me as long as she did, and that a relationship was a mistake. And that she should have done this far sooner.
Oh, fuck. She
obviously doesn't mean that. She's trying to push her away, because she doesn't want Hyun-ae to stay attached to her. She's trying to push her away, because she thinks it'll be better for her in the end.
But those are such horrible things to say.
Fine, I screamed at her. If that's how it is, fine, I'll get out of your life and leave you alone to your precious, kind, and generous man. I started to storm off. Wait, please, don't leave like that. Please stay, she begged. Our relationship is doomed, but it doesn't mean I didn't like being with you. Please, stay one more night. I couldn't bear it if my last memory of you was a sad one. I thought her voice was always so graceful before. Right then, I realized it wasn't. It was pitiful. It was always pitiful. She was trying to manipulate me. Probably like she'd done with that patron. Probably like she'd done with me before. It wasn't charming, it wasn't playful elegance. It was a pitiful lie. So I told her the truth. I hate you! I screamed at her, and ran away. I don't know what to do now. I tried not to let my family see me like this, but, well, there's only a paper screen in between us. I'm such a mess. I just can't believe she'd do that to me. I can't believe after I made the hard decision, she made the easy one and threw me away. Writing this has calmed me down a little, at least. And now the reality sinks in. I have nothing now. I guess all I can do now is apologize to my dad and hope that I get a second chance. I guess that's all I can do. I can't believe she'd do that to me. I hate her. Yeah, that was really painful to read. Yeah, it was. Jesus. Yeah, what does she have now? A flower stall that doesn't even really bring in any income? Living in a packed home? With everyone poor? No one to love? Jesus. Please, something good happen, please. Something really good happen. Something really nice. That would be nice. Anything. Okay, that's the end of it for today. This is the end of it, right? Unread? Yeah, okay. Okay, we have 31% power. Let's grab some more. Sorry, Hyun-ae. You'll be back in just a second. You know, I better save the game just in case it crashes or something. Okay.